Hello, everyone, and welcome to another Planetarium show. First up, I'm sorry for any confusion with the date that we were going to be doing this. Originally, we had planning for an event tonight, which pushed the stream to what was supposed to be tomorrow, but then because of the winter storm, everything got postponed and delayed, and I decided let's just go ahead and stream on the night that we normally do. So here I am. I am solo tonight because my usual student helper, Brayden, is off on a tour with his choir group, I believe. So I may be a little slow responding to, questions and comments and stuff, but just feel free to put them down in the comments and I'll keep an eye on it. But since we are in March, believe it or not, still struggling with that, we are doing our monthly What's Up show tonight to give you a little bit of information on the astronomical events that you can look forward to for March. So let me get things switched over. There we go. All right. So to start us off, we are going to be talking about something happening a little bit later in the month, which is the March equinox. For us here in the Northern Hemisphere, it's also known as the spring or vernal equinox, and this will take place on March 20th. So essentially what's happening here, the Earth in its orbit around the Sun is tilted slightly by about 23 and a half degrees. So that means sometimes of the year, we're tilted a little bit towards. Sometimes in the year, we're tilted a little bit away. And while we're tilted towards and away, that affects the amount of sunlight that we get, how high the sun is, the intensity of sunlight we're getting, and that all results in our summer and winter seasons. Now, on the equinoxes, this is halfway between our mostly tilted towards and mostly tilted away. The Earth is actually neither tilted towards nor away and looks more like this. So it is the two times of year where the Earth is no longer tilted, and we actually get an equal amount of daytime and nighttime, hence equinox for equal night. So we get roughly 12 hours of day and 12 hours of night. And we see this as the kind of transition between spring, or sorry, between winter and summer. In this case, since we are heading from winter towards the summer, this is, of course, our spring equinox for us here in the Northern Hemisphere. In the Southern, their seasons are flipped, so this would be technically their fall equinox. But it is the only time of year where we have that equal day and night. This does mean for us, our days are going to continue to get longer and longer. I'm definitely appreciating seeing the sun still up, at 5 p.m. But it's also the only time of year where the sun rises due east and sets due west. That only happens on the equinox for most locations on Earth. There are some that have it more, but that's a different show. So for most people, this is the only time of year during one of the 2 days of the equinox that we get the sun rising in the due east and setting in the due west. Otherwise, normally it's rising and setting a little more north or south, depending on the season. So yeah, start of spring happening on March 20th. All right, let's take a look at where did my moon? I normally had a nice pretty moon. Anyway, let's take a look at what the moon is doing this month. So we are starting the month off with a full moon. That's going to happen on the 7th. For the month of March, the full moon is often called the worm moon. Then after that, around the 14th, we'll have the third quarter. 21st will be the new moon, and the 28th, coming up at the end of the month, will be the first quarter. And you can see here the rise and set times for the different phases, because you do see different phases up at different times of day and night. And it's all because of where the moon is positioned relative to the Earth and the Sun. And that's, of course, what gives us the phases as well. All right, now on to the planets. Our morning sky is not looking that active anymore. If you are lucky, and have a nice, perfectly flat horizon over in the east, you might see Saturn and Mercury there just barely peeking out before the sun rises. But for most people, you're probably not going to see that quite yet. So luckily, though, Saturn is going to continuously get higher and higher in the eastern sky. So by the end of the month, which I'll show you in a bit, you'll be able to see it a bit better. Mercury is actually heading the other way, though. It's getting closer and closer to the sun, and it's actually going to pass the sun on the 17th and reappear over in the nighttime sky, the evening sky, by the end of the month. So speaking of evening sky, let's go take a look at that. So this is tonight, and we can see Jupiter, Venus, Uranus, Mars, and the Moon up tonight. All of our planets here will be visible pretty much all month long. Jupiter's going to get really difficult to see towards the end of the month. But right now, Jupiter and Venus, as you can see here, are right next to each other. So if you were to look through like a pair of binoculars, you get a nice view of the two planets next to each other. Jupiter is slowly making its way towards the sun, so it's going to be moving southward, it's going to be moving down towards the horizon over the month. Venus, on the other hand, is making its way out from the sun, so it's going to be moving up away from the horizon throughout the month. And Mars is just going to keep hanging out up there in our nighttime sky. So this is about mid-month. You can see Venus and Jupiter have separated. Venus is starting to make its way up to Uranus. Jupiter getting pretty low in the western sky. And then by the end of the month, just like I said, Jupiter getting really low, difficult to see, but Mercury is going to start peeking out of the western sky right at the end of the month. And Venus will have made its way right next to Uranus. So that is another opportunity to pull out your telescope or pair of binoculars and get a cool view of the two planets together. In fact, this would be a really great way to actually try and find Uranus. It's not usually visible to the naked eye. You do have to have, a telescope or a pair of binoculars to see them. So knowing that it's going to be right near Venus can actually make it easier for you to try and find it and identify it. And then, like I said, we still got Mars there hanging out with us in our nighttime sky. And just to bring it back, as I said, once we get to the end of the month, Saturn is going to become a bit more visible there in our morning sky. Still pretty low, but it's slowly getting higher and higher in our pre-dawn, early morning sky. And that is what we can expect out of the planets. Neptune, we're not really able to see this month. It is making its way around the sun. So it's going to be out of view for us for a good while. But yeah, that's our planets. All right, another thing you can see, and I talked about this last month as well, but this month is another good month to see it, is the zodiacal light. So the zodiacal light, let me just go ahead and go to the screen here, is caused because there's a bunch of dust and little grains of sand strewn all throughout the solar system in between the planets. And the sunlight can kind of reflect off of this dust scattered in the solar system. And so at two times of year, in the spring and in the fall, this glow from the sunlight reflecting off of this dust in the solar system happens to be at a steeper angle to our horizon, which makes it easier for us to see. So if you want to try and get a glimpse of the zodiacal light, a good time to do it is going to be between March 9th and March 21st. You're going to want to head out right after sunset. Give yourself a good half hour of viewing time after the sun is set, after it's gotten dark, and you're going to look over into the western sky where you'll see Venus and Jupiter lined up, and you should see this faint little wedge of light along them, and that is your zodiacal lights. Now, you do have to have really dark skies to be able to see this. So if you can travel outside of the city or happen to live further out, that would be your best bet. Just be careful not to confuse it with the Milky Way, which is more over towards the northwest. And this is an image that someone got of the zodiacal light. So you can see the glow of it and then the Milky Way cutting over this way. This is not what it's going to look like to your eye. It is going to be much fainter than this. That's the one benefit of cameras. You can keep the shutter open. You can expose for longer than your eyes accumulate light for. So you're able to see those fainter things more easily. But you can see it if you have the right conditions and, you know, dark enough skies. All right, and last up, let's take a look at what the International Space Station is doing for the month. The International Space Station, of course, houses several astronauts at a time as they are up there taking care of the space station, but also doing different scientific experiments. Because of the very large solar panels that you can see in the image there, they can easily reflect sunlight. And when they're oriented just right, you can see that sunlight bouncing off of those solar panels. And that's what makes us see the space station as it flies overhead. You're seeing that sunlight reflecting off of the panels. So depending on exactly how its orbit is as it's orbiting around the Earth, different locations on the Earth can see the space station at different times. For us here in Duluth, there's not a lot of opportunities in March. This is it. If you live in a different location, you can always head to this website down here, heavens-above.com. And put in your location, and it will give you exactly this sort of information for your location so you could see when it's visible to you. But this is really great because it gives us, you know, the date and time that it'll happen. It'll tell us how bright it is. Now, brightness is given in magnitudes, which is kind of a reverse scale. So the smaller the number, the brighter it is. And then once you've found a date and time that look good to you, if you were to click on that date, it'll take you to a second page that will show you a map of the sky with the path of the space station and, excuse me, the exact timings of when it's going to be there. Now, the space station isn't the only satellite that you can see. In fact, given dark skies and out for, you know, at least half an hour, you're probably going to see at least one satellite, probably even a couple. The best kind of tell that I have for satellite versus, say, airplane, if it's moving and blinking, it's an airplane. If it's moving and not blinking, it's probably a satellite. And there are sites that you can use to look up, you know, exactly which satellite it is you saw, but they are pretty common to see in our nighttime sky. If you just, you know, pay attention enough, you'll definitely see some. All right, well, that is the end to our astronomical events for March. Not too terribly much going on, although we do still have some great planet viewing there in our evening and nighttime sky. So let's take a look at what's going on at the Planetarium. Our shows for this weekend, Friday is Adventure to the Edge of the Universe. Saturday, we are starting a new batch of shows for the month of March. Our family show is Two Small Pieces of Glass, and our general public show at the on Saturday evening is Europe to the Stars. And then you can join us back here next week on Wednesday for our next stream, which will be our constellation show for March. Now, I want to show a quick little trailer for our two Saturday shows because they are pretty great. So first up is Two Small Pieces of Glass, which again is our family show showing at 2 p.m. on Saturdays. All right. So again, that was our family show, and this is our general public show showing Saturdays at 7 p.m. And this is Europe to the Stars.
This is the story of an epic adventure. A story of cosmic curiosity, courage, and perseverance. The story of how Europe went south to explore the stars.
So a great group of shows for this month, both focused on telescopes, with our family show being obviously oriented a bit more for a younger audience, looking at the basics of how a telescope works and a little bit of the history behind them. And then our evening show getting more into kind of the big research telescopes that astronomers use and the cool stuff that we have learned with them. So a really fun pairing of shows for March. Lastly, don't forget to mark your calendars for Astronomy Day, which is going to happen on Saturday, April 1st from 6 to 9 p.m. We will have planetarium shows, activities, telescope viewing, weather permitting, of course. It's free, fun for all ages, and going to be a really great time. And I can officially give the first piece of very cool information. We are going to be having a super fun raffle this year for Astronomy Day, where we are going to be raffling off this beautiful tabletop telescope. So come to the event and buy a raffle ticket, which are going to be $1. It's $1 raffle ticket. And you could possibly win this amazing telescope. It's a great one. And we'll have some other raffle prizes as well. I'm waiting on confirmation on one of them, so I can't share the others yet. We're also going to have a guest presentation by Bob King, aka Astro Bob, who's going to be fantastic. It's going to be a great time. So yeah, that is our Astronomy Day, and we'll have more and more information coming out about it over the next several weeks. All right, let me go check our comments here. Hi, Mom. Let's see. Been seeing some incredible Northern Lights videos lately. Do you expect that to continue, or is it coming to an end? Great question, and you made me remember that I wanted to show some of those and completely forgot to include it. So I am going to go look that up real quick, and I'll answer the second part of your question. So yes, we expect to see a continued increase in Northern Lights because the activity of the Northern Lights is associated with the sun and the sun's activity. And the sun's activity is slowly picking up over the next few years as it heads into solar maximum. And so as the sun gets more active, we're going to see a lot more and stronger auroral displays. And that's why we had some increased ones over the past few nights, is the sun had a little active spell. And so if you are ever interested in checking out some of the Northern Lights displays that we have here in northern Minnesota, we actually have an all-sky camera located up at the Chickwack Museum and Nature Center. There is a link to it in the video description. We also have a Facebook page here, and it posts the nightly time-lapse videos that are taken, this looks like it's going to be a good one. So to give you an idea of our camera here. So yeah, they had some really cool aurora. And I was actually shocked to see this much activity because this really bright thing you're seeing here, that's the moon. So the fact that we had a really bright moon and still saw some bright aurora activity, like if we didn't have a moon that night, it probably would have been even more stunning. And then we get some clouds coming in. But yeah, you can always check out our all sky camera if you want to see some of the aurora activity happening up here. All right. Did I lose? No, there we go. Okay. Let's see, we got another question. Are the poles reversing? Ooh. I'm assuming you're meaning the, like, Earth's magnetic poles. That's a complicated question. Yes. But we're not sure how quickly or when the reversal is actually going to take place. So we know that the Earth's magnetic poles have switched multiple times throughout the 4.5 billion years that the Earth has been around. Because you can actually see that in the geologic record, because any magnetic elements that are in rocks as they're solidifying, they line up with the Earth's magnetic field. So if you look at that over, you know, the spans of millions and billions of years, you can actually see it flipping direction. So that's how we know that the poles have reversed. And technically, based off of the record, we're kind of overdue for a reversal of the poles. We don't know for sure when that's going to happen. We also don't know what it's going to look like or what effects it's going to have, because we don't know if it's going to be a really quick, sudden thing or if it's going to take a really long time for the reversal to happen. And depending on the scenario, that could create very different effects on us. So yeah, short answer, yes. Slightly more longer answer, yes, but not really, and also we're just not sure. Let's see, is there any relation to the increased solar flare? No, that has nothing to do with the reversal of the poles. That is entirely due to everything going on inside of the Earth, because our magnetic field is generated in the liquid outer core of the Earth. So it has to do with that, which again, we don't fully understand what's going on there. But yeah, now that doesn't have any effect. The sun doesn't have any effect on that. Let's see. Is there an app you recommend for tracking aurora activity? Yes. So let me see if I can pull it up real quick. There is, I don't know how well you're going to be able to see it. There is an app called Aurora. I don't think you can see it very well. It's just called Aurora. It's a free app. It's really great. It gives you some predictions, but what I love about it is you can set up notifications so that it will actually give you an alert when it looks like there's increased aurora activity for your location. And so, yeah, I mean, I've been getting alerts for the past few days, but that's the one I recommend, and it's really great. When was the last reversal? I don't remember. I know it was at least several hundred thousands of years. Let's see if I can find out real quick. Last reversal of Earth's magnetic field. Yeah, so very, very quick search says about 770,000 years ago. Yeah, that's the last, my very, very quick search. So yeah, had some questions tonight. This has been fun. All right. I'll give just a couple. Let's just go one more minute to see if there are any other great questions. This is a lot harder to do when I'm by myself and don't have someone else to banter with, but yes, completely pre-digital world. Yeah, and that's why it's so hard for us to know what effect it's going to have. Because even though we see that like it's switched, we don't have a good idea, like I was saying, the length of time that it took. We don't know. I wouldn't like lose sleep over this. But yeah, it's something that can happen. All right. I think just looking through, making sure I didn't miss anything else or anything in the comments. I think we will wrap it up there. Thank you for joining me. Hope you enjoyed the show. Like I said, show's happening this weekend. We're still streaming every week on Wednesdays. Astronomy Day on April 1st. Come hang out with us. I think that's it. So thanks again. Have a wonderful evening. If you are in the Minnesota area, stay safe because we've had a heck of a winter storm today. Have a great evening and great week, everyone. We'll see you next time. Bye.